Beauty is a well-understood concept, but it's also difficult to define. Part of the challenge with identifying beauty is that it varies from culture to culture or even within cultures. Beauty can be defined by visual characteristics, such as the shape of one's physical body or whether someone wears a specific type of jewelry. It can also be defined by knowledge or other personality characteristics that are actually pretty difficult to measure. Given the subjective nature of beauty, how does your brain translate this into a meaningful experience? One in which we all understand. How do we even define such a broad concept, and how do we measure it when asking questions about the brain? So today, let's explore the neuroscience of beauty. But before I do, subscribe to this channel and hit that bell so that you never miss a new episode about that thing in your head. No, not that idea of how you will completely reinvent yourself over the summer. You know, that was kind of a big theme in those coming-of-age movies in like the early 2000s. And while there's nothing wrong with a bit of self-improvement, what we all should be striving for is to really love ourselves and recognize that we are always going to be flawed in some way to someone. Now, what was I talking about? The brain. Before I get started, I have a question for you. Do you believe we can actually define beauty? Leave me a comment below. When scientists investigate beauty, what we attempt to understand is aesthetic appreciation. This kind of appreciation has traditionally been isolated to the arts, but when you give it a bit more thought, this does expand to our general understanding of what you may consider to be beautiful. There is evidence supporting overlapping areas in the brain regarding how we may appreciate the arts and how we appreciate beauty in what is biologically necessary, such as mate selection. I know that this sounds really reductionistic, but stay with me. From an evolutionary biological approach, natural selection as a whole has ensured that the general population uses mechanisms of beauty as a means to select mates. However, nature is full of variety. After all, variety is the spice of life. So people who fall outside of the heteronormative understanding of attraction and mate selection are not biologically flawed. They are just a product of the variation that is necessary for our survival as a species. If you have a problem with what I just said, you are more than welcome to watch any of my other videos on this channel. A lot to choose from. Check them out. Okay, moving on. So according to neuroimaging studies, brain mechanisms responsible for artistic appreciation may be the same mechanisms involved in the appreciation of physical beauty in others. In a report examining nearly 100 neuroimaging studies, an area of the brain consistently activated under aesthetic appraisal paradigms was the anterior insula, which is weird because the anterior insula has been primarily associated with pain and disgust. What is going on here? Well, while it's not entirely clear, what researchers proposed that initial appraisal of anything essentially involves understanding if something is harmful or beneficial. And this part of the brain, the anterior insula, is very good at making these judgments very quickly. Above anything else, aesthetic appreciation is an emotionally based judgment before it is more thought through. This would actually help explain the irrationality of attraction towards people who will never reciprocate. No one wants to be in that state. It is super distressing, and then you ask, well, what do you like about them? And all I can think of is, well, I don't know, I think they're hot. After your right anterior insula determines if something, such as the appearance of another individual, is good or bad for you, that information is then processed in the orbitofrontal cortex, or OFC, an area of the brain that is associated with higher order processing regarding social and emotional information. This part of the brain is not well understood, but it is an area of the brain that is becoming a little bit more researched. It's actually a lot more researched. And it does seem to play a pivotal role in integrating sensory, emotional, and social information. The way in which these two areas interpret beauty can be viewed as such. The insula makes a quick pre-judgment based on emotion, and the OFC makes a more thought-through judgment as it has access to more information. I don't know why I said that like you were a toddler, because you're not. Smart people. I think I make this point a lot in my videos pertaining to making judgments, but I'm reiterating. Our assessments are emotional before they're ever rational, if they're ever rational at all. So give some thought to the way in which you think. Whether it is a piece of literature or someone else's amazingly warm, giving personality, these things too may be beautiful and therefore can be aesthetically appreciated by the same neural mechanisms. I am pretty certain that this kind of aesthetic appreciation is not particularly controversial for the vast majority of us. Where we encounter a bit more disagreement is when we attempt to define and identify the attractiveness of other people. Regarding physical beauty, there are two competing approaches in understanding how we, as a species, understand the physical beauty of others, the universalists and the culturalists. Let's start with the universalists. Universalists maintain that there is a universal standard of beauty and that this standard is consistent regardless of culture and ornamentation, that is jewelry, body paint, makeup. For instance, these researchers have gone through the process of finding universally attractive faces and body features. They maintain that an attractive face is proportional, and even infants attend longer to these proportional faces than to faces that lack a certain proportion ratio. They go on to argue that beauty is literally skin deep. It is the appearance of youth and lacking signs of aging such as scars, because these signs point towards reproductive health. However, as culturalists have rightfully pointed out, this is a very westernized concept of beauty. Consider the practice of scarification. In some cultures, they intentionally created scars on their body, as it marked life stages and was considered beautiful. It has since fallen out of practice, but highlights something very important. Our standards of beauty are flexible and often culturally defined. So while there may be something to a universal standard of beauty, never discount how your surroundings directly impact your beliefs and your behaviors. If you liked what you watched, subscribe to my channel and share with family and friends. Also make sure to hit that like button. Also, if you want to support my channel with big brainiac energy, then head on over to my Patreon page to become a contributing member. And as always, thank you for feeding your brain with Brief Brain Snacks.